This is a copyrighted work. Unauthorized copying or distribution is a crime punishable by up to 5 years in prison and a fine of $250,000.
Scholastic Audio presents Martin Rising, Requiem for a King. Written and read for you by Andrea Davis Pinkney. Illustrated by Brian Pinkney. Henny, Penny, Prelude. Here she is, hind feathers hightailing. Her birdie eyes, filled with foresight, see far down the road. Peck, peck, prophecy. Henny, Penny, know-it-all she-bird, guards her eggs like a mystery riddle, invites us to inquire. What's inside the future's shell? Who holds the yoke of tomorrow? When the time comes, what cracks open? Can chicks survive after the sky falls? Daylight. Sparkling-eyed child, January 15, 1929. Baby boy born, eyes sparkling. Martin came into this Jim Crow world, brought daylight to this unfair world, this legal too-cheap blacks world, with God-given gifts. Big voice, sharp mind, sparkling-eyed vision that could see something special in tomorrow's promise. He studied oratory, sociology, theology, and excelled. When he became a full-grown man, he found a place in history as he fulfilled his destiny to fight for full equality. As scholar, preacher, believer, and teacher of what it means to dream. With those sparkling eyes always looking ahead, Martin found the path of light, of love, and truth, the Bible, his beacon. He stepped right up to the teachings that nourished the world's greatest minds, Lincoln, Thoreau, Tolstoy, and Gandhi, whose heart was warmed by the wisdom woven in the Sermon on the Mount. These greats were Martin's North Star, the compass that led him to the mountaintop. He knew deep down he had to climb to reach the promised land, along with his close companion, nonviolence. And so Martin took that trip, rode the Montgomery bus boycott, strode through Selma, wrote a letter from Birmingham jail, marched on Washington, where he told his eager followers, "I have a dream." On that unforgettable day, glorious, triumphant, on that peace-filled afternoon when not one drop of violence spilled, what did the now a man, who was once the gifted child with sparkling eyes, see into future's face? Did he know what horizon's hand held? Did he understand that to be born with so many gifts was a privilege that had a price? How could he know? How could he foretell? To come so far, to stand so high, all he knew was that he had to keep climbing to the top of the mountain at all costs. It seems that Martin, the sparkling-eyed child, born leader of his people, was put here to do just that. Happy birthday, Daddy, January 15, 1968. 39 candles on a buttercream cake. A sweet birthday mix of sugar and vanilla. A cinnamon pinch invites good luck. Batter drips thick ribbons on this just-right gift. Two tin pans slide from the oven in a Georgia kitchen. Golden moons, sweet steam rising, cooled, stacked, ready to be dressed in snowy colored cloaks for the birthday party of a lifetime. Whipped egg whites form frothy frosting, licked clean from Coretta's wooden spoon. Eager fingers scoop the spoon's delight. Yolanda, Martin III, Dexter, Bernice, Martin's children chant, "Happy birthday, dear Daddy." Laughter tickles, make a wish, one steady heave of his barrel chest, puffed cheeks, then, quick, a mighty blow. Out go the tiny flares, sending itty-bitty smokestacks into a cloud that surrounds Martin's Papa Bear grin. The candle smoke haze forms a halo of happy round this family fun. Coretta corrals her brood, gathers them while she plays proud piano. Butterscotch fingers grace 88 keys that unlock celebration songs for Daddy. Spirituals, R&B, silly ditties fill the room, fill these hearts with so much love. Papa Bear Martin hugs his cubs. Somebody shouts, "Let's all sing." A king chorus rejoices, "This little lot of mine. Shooby dooby doo da day. Merrily, merrily, merrily. Life is but a dream." Forcing for Scythia, February 11, 1968. Impatient for winter's end, gardeners trudge through snow-crusted beds, smothered in stubborn white, refusing to melt from fence posts and lawns. The most determined search for ready bushes crisscrossed with jutting branches, twisted, eager candidates shooting forth to greet sharpened pruning shears, clip-snap, snip, snip. Gathered twiglets, stems soaked in warm water, wet promise that will course through twiglet veins, coaxing, cajoling, forcing for Scythia's frilly flowers. So golden, so pretty, proud, smiling from a cold steamed window, frozen shut against winter's final weeks. In Memphis, Tennessee, on this same frigid February day, another kind of flower rears its face. Twisted, ugly blooms of discrimination. On this day, in the heart of Tennessee, aka the Volunteer State, branches of the city's government refuse black sanitation workers equal pay. These garbage collectors have not volunteered for this. They have not raised their hands for degradation. Yet, like for Scythia, they are forced. Forced to slog through snowy streets, gathering rotted trash and waste. Forced to take low wages. Forced to drive broken trucks. Forced to work when sick. Forced to collect paychecks that can't afford coats for their children who shiver and are hungry on this day in Tennessee, the Volunteer State. 10 days ago, when two garbage collectors seeking shelter from heavy rains in their truck's compactor are crushed, all the sanitation workers are forced to speak up. Their pleas are ignored, their requests silenced, their civil rights neglected, their humanity rejected. Enough, they shout.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.